Welcome all of you and to the 98th instruction course of this AIOS clinical practice in uveitis lessons learned. And we have an esteemed panel of speakers in our instruction course. We have Dr. JB, Dr. Padma, Dr. Mudit, Dr. Amit, Dr. Manisha, Dr. Bala. And before we start with the talk from the panelists, we have the keynote address. And before I introduce the course, this course is basically about solving various diagnostic and clinical challenges in terms of management and diagnosis. So uveitis has, you know, a lot of dilemmas that it presents to us, and unnecessarily some of the patients are taken to a battery of laboratory tests. So here, this instruction course is a case-based course where all the experts are going to show their experiences and are going to give you some key points on how to pick up these important clues before we, you know, jump to empirical treatment or before we jump to unnecessary tests. So before we move on to the talks, we have a keynote address by Dr. Mary Jose Obin, who's going to talk on infectious uveitis pulse for diagnosis and treatment. And she, I think I would introduce her briefly. She has a huge CV. She's a uveitis specialist in Montreal, Canada, with a double appointment, associate professor in the University of Montreal and Faculty of Medicine in University of Montreal. She got her medical degree at McGill University, followed by her residency in ophthalmology from University of Montreal. She did a fellowship in uveitis in France, and she holds a master's in public health, and she holds a master's in public health ophthalmology, and on. And her research areas include access to eye care services, international blindness prevention, screening strategies in ophthalmology, and study of infectious and inflammatory eye diseases. Engaged in various public health international activities. So let's hear her on infectious uveitis pulse for diagnosis and treatment, and then we move on to our panelists for their individual talks. So can we have you, Dr. Robin?
Hello, everyone. Thank you for the invitation to speak. My name is Marie-José Aubin, and I'll be sharing with you pearls on infectious uveitis, especially for diagnostic purposes and treatment. So let's start. Actually, it's 4:30 in Montreal, so I just had double coffee to be able to speak today. So let us first review the epidemiology of infectious uveitis and we'll recognize the various presentations of infectious uveitis in order to refine your diagnostic strategy and treatment option. So certainly uveitis can be quite challenging, even overwhelming, and hopefully with these 10 pearls or do's and don'ts, you'll feel better equipped to take care of your patients. The first pearl in diagnosis and treatment is to do a complete examination. Please don't start right ahead with the slit lamp. Take some time to look at the patient face and skin, and rely on your uveitis classification and knowledge of the epidemiology of uveitis to guide you towards the correct diagnosis. For example, for enterouveitis, idiopathic enterouveitis is the most common. HLA-B27 is certainly a frequent association. And in terms of infectious disease, think of the group herpes and of syphilis. For intermediate uveitis, actually it's the rarest kind of uveitis, most commonly found in young adults. And certainly in elderly, you need to think of intraocular lymphoma. And as for infectious causes, always think of syphilis. Posterior uveitis, toxoplasmosis is the most common cause. In endemic countries like India, think of TB, VKH in Asia, and again, always syphilis. For panuveitis, your usual suspects, toxoplasmosis, the herpes group, and syphilis. Look for clues. Know what you look for. You have to start before giving anesthetic drops to do corneal aesthesia. And if there's a central distribution of keepies together with iris atrophy, especially sectorial atrophy and hypertension of the eye, it leads you towards the viral herpetic diagnosis. So KP distribution is important, KP size as well. This is the R triangle with the granulomatous mutton fat KPs. And this is commonly found in sarcoidosis as well as in infectious uveitis, such as toxoplasmosis herpes. But remember that granulomatous uveitis might start as non-granulomatous. We already discussed that high IOP should make you think of herpes, but also toxoplasmosis. And always
Dr. Auburn, we cannot hear you.
Can we see the slides? Because I have stopped seeing the slides also now.
I think there's some problem with her connection. We are trying to get in touch with her.
Okay.
Can we go to the next one in the meantime? Come back.
Let's just wait for 30 seconds. If she can get back, then it's good, or else we'll just go to our next presenter and ask her to present in some time.
The slides have frozen, I think. They're not moving. So I think we'll start with our speakers and then we can have a talk in the end.
Or we can do that. We can go ahead towards our next speaker, as I think there's some problem with our connection. So we can go ahead with our next speaker, and once she's back, we'll have a
text her personally, because I don't think she knows that her slides are not moving here, and
I'll just ask our technical team to work on it.
Right. So meanwhile, can we have
you can ask the other person to start sharing the slide.
Dr. Mudit? Dr. Mudit, can we have you?
Yes, ma'am. Yes. I'm there. Yes. Can you see my slides?
Not now, sir.
Are my slides visible?
Not yet, Mudit. We can see you.
Yeah. It's there in front of me. Let me just then reshare it then. Just now, are they visible?
Now it's coming.
Am I visible?
No. Not yet, sir.
Yes.
Now it's visible.
No, but now it is in a... All right. Let me just see it. Now...
Was it probably you have some internet connection problem?
No, I don't have. I was able to see everything well. Let me do one thing. Sometimes it gets stuck. Let me log out and log in again. Give me just 10 seconds.
I can see your slides. I can see your slides.
See the slides.
Yeah.
Thanks, but your audio is going.
Just one second. I'll just.
If you can switch off your video, mute your video, then your connectivity will be faster.
Just give me 1 second and I will be there. Yeah. Are they visible now?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
All right. So I'll start. So good afternoon, everyone. Thanks to AIOC and to Dr. Reema Bansal for this wonderful instruction course. And I'll be talking about some scenarios where lab investigations may not be required. Now, we have to look at this statement from two different perspectives. Why do we need lab investigations? We need them either to make diagnosis or what happened? Yeah. We need lab investigations either to make a diagnosis or we need lab investigations to help in managing our patients, because sometimes we might be starting our patients some immunosuppression or some steroids and we need to monitor them. So before that, sometimes investigations are needed, but a lot of times we do not need investigations to arrive at a diagnosis. Lot of our clinical diseases, lot of uveitic entities are clinical diagnosis, and you can arrive at them just by a good comprehensive clinical examination and by taking a good detailed history. So I will not go into a lot of diseases, but I'll cover a few common clinical diseases which we do see in our clinics, which can be easy, common clinical diagnosis where you do not need to resort to an extensive battery of tests. So let me show you first case. So this was a lady who presented with a bilateral hypopyon in both eyes, had shallow angles. Our ultrasound B scan revealed the presence of choroidal detachments. And whenever you see a sudden onset bilateral uveal effusion with a hypopyon and a myopic shift, one of the differentials should be a drug-induced uveitis. So in these cases, a very good important tool is taking a meticulous history. And history taking is important for all forms of medical diseases, but this entity highlights how important a good clinical history and evaluation can be. So when we took a bit, which had been started by a physician 15 days ago, we stopped topiramate and the clinical condition improved. So whenever you see a patient with a bilateral hypopyon uveitis, you do not have to suddenly resort or jump to a battery of tests. You need to go back, reassess the patient and ask for a history of what are the drugs which are started upon. So drugs like topiramate, chlorthalidone, trimethoprim, sulfamethoxazole, and even acetazolamide, or what we commonly use as Dimox, can lead to such a rare presentation. So go back to your patient, take a good history, and you will not have to do an extensive battery of tests. You, just by a good history, you may be able to arrive at a diagnosis in this case. So like I said, these are the agents which are known to cause this presentation. Another common presentation which you can see in patients who are on ATT, and if they've been started on rifabutin, a patient comes to you with a bilateral sudden onset hypopyon and is on treatment for tuberculosis ATT, ask them again about the drug history. And rifabutin is also known to cause a hypopyon uveitis. So an anterior uveitis is a dose dependent effect of rifabutin, and this condition may be asymmetrical, and the hypopyon may resolve just by cessation of rifabutin. So again, importance of taking a good history. You go back and ask your patient what are the medications they are on, and that will save you the trouble of extensively investigating your patient. You will know what is the cause for the uveitis which is manifesting in front of you. Let me show you a few more clinical examples of some other diseases which are common clinical diagnoses where you do not need extensive investigations. So before that, a list of drugs causing anterior uveitis, and the most common ones are rifabutin, sulfonamides, sometimes even bisphosphonates. Let me come to one more clinical entity. So this was a lady who presented to us with complaint of diminution of vision. And if you see over here, you see this fluid over here, you see this lesion at the foveal area. And subsequently, if you do an FFA of this patient, you will see multiple pinpoint leakages, diffuse hyperfluorescence, multiple pinpoint leakages, leaking in the late phases and subsequent staining. An OCT will show this characteristic elevation in RP undulations and fluid and SRF accumulation over here. And subsequently, if you do a B scan for this patient, you see this characteristic T sign, which is basically collection of fluid in the subtenon space. So you put all of these four signs and the investigations together. You see this nodular elevation. You see these changes on OCT, multiple pinpoint leakages on FFA and a T sign. And you do not again have to resort to investigations. You know that you are dealing with a nodular posterior scleritis. So again, when you put all of these clinical signs together, you can arrive at a clinical diagnosis without resorting to loads of investigations. Third clinical entity, again, where you see these multiple neurosensory detachments, which can be more appreciated in the red free image, and then early hypo, multiple pinpoint leakages subsequently in all phases, and then staining and leak accumulation of this dye over here. You know what you're the same picture in the eyes, multiple pinpoint leakages. And that again is an indicator of the fact that you are dealing with a VKS. So you see multiple NSDs, disc hyperemia, pinpoint leakages on FFA, RP undulations on OCT. Put all of these signs and investigations together, you know that you are dealing with a VKH, and you again don't have to resort to extensive investigations. However, if you see a similar sort of picture and the patient gives a history of trauma or having undergone an intraocular surgery in the past, more so vitreoretinal surgery, then your diagnosis becomes a sympathetic ophthalmia. Again, clinical picture and a detailed history, having a diagnosis of. Similarly, if a patient presents to you with extensive hemorrhages, retinitis, areas of central clearing, peripheral retinitis, arteriolar sheathing, and a patient is seropositive, you know that you may be probably dealing with a CMV risk of going ahead and doing a TAP or trying to investigate further. But the fact is that this clinical picture in itself is sufficient to let you arrive at a diagnosis of a CMV retinitis. Again, the point to remember is that in these cases, a lot of times you might not see extensive vitritis because the patients may be immune. However, if you see a patient with this extensive peripheral wedge-like lesions, you know again that this is acute retinal necrosis. So again, clinical diagnosis where you don't have to resort to a lot of investigations. And then these are one of my favorite slides, which I keep on showing and talking about again and again. If you see a patient with this plecoid chororetinitis or these multiple pinpoint leakages and a ground glass retinitis, while in this case you do need an investigation to confirm your diagnosis, clinically this is ocular syphilis. And a TPHA, while it will help confirming your diagnosis, these are images which are a clinical clue to what you're dealing with. So the point I'm trying to make over here is the fact that lot of uveitic diagnosis can be made clinically. You do not have to resort to an extensive long battery of tests. You don't have to subject your patients to that. Again, if you see a patient with single lesion of a retinitis or a unifocal choroiditis or retinochoroiditis, again, one of your most common differentials is a toxoplasmosis. So you see a patient with a unifocal retinochoroiditis, most probably you are dealing with an ocular toxoplasmosis. And last case for today, this was a lady who came to us with a history of decreased vision in both eyes, gave a history of having undergone a hysterectomy 2 weeks back, presents with these two lesions in the right eye and one more lesion in the left eye with vitritis. When you do an OCT, you see this subretinal lesion over here, and the other eye shows this rain cloud sort of an appearance and this lesion abutting into the vitreous cavity. Clinically, this was candida endophthalmitis. We did a biopsy also for this patient, which came out to be actually negative. But the fact is that we subsequently treated this patient, and I will just go to this slide later on, but we treated this patient subsequently with just amphotericin B based on the clinical appearance. And even though the culture was negative, and even the PCR was negative, subsequently with just amphotericin B, the lesion started regressing. And the vision, which was hand movement at the start, became 20/200 and counting this close to face. And subsequently 20/200, 20/60, 20/80 in both eyes. So based on the clinical appearance, also you can get a hint that you might be dealing with a candida endophthalmitis or an endogenous endophthalmitis, where the underlying organism may be candida, even though the PCR as well as the microbiology was negative in this case. So the point is that a lot of times your clinical skills can be much more valuable than a huge battery of laboratory tests. And once you put all of those clinical clues together, you will be able to arrive at a diagnosis in most of these cases. Thank you so much. And I'll stop my share now.
Thank you, Dr. Mudit, for wonderful cases and wonderful summarizing it very well. And Mudit, we all know, I always enjoy his talks. Very prominent uveitis specialist from LV Prasad, Hyderabad. And before we move on to the next talk, can we have Dr. Robin? Because we lost touch with the Zoom. So are you okay if we have your talk now?
Yes, thank you. I'll share my slides. I'm very sorry for the connection. I'm very far away from you. And actually, this is a very nice follow-up to this this talk, as I'll be speaking about infectious uveitis again, sharing with you a clinical pearls for diagnosis and treatment. So we'll quickly go along this talk, and as we go along, we'll see some epidemiology of infectious disease and review some presentation. I'll share with you some cases in order to refine your diagnostic and treatment skills. So of course, uveitis is a challenging because it presents in so various way, and there's so many different causes for it. But hopefully with these pearls, you'll feel better equipped. So the first pearl is to do a complete eye exam and not to jump over the patient, but actually look at him and ask questions prior to going on to slit lamp examination and so on. To rely on your anatomical classification, this is not only for students, but it actually can guide you toward the correct diagnosis. For example, in anterior uveitis, we know idiopathic is common, HLA-B27, a frequent association, but in terms of infectious disease, you need to think of group herpes and of syphilis. For intermediate uveitis, it's the rarest kind, most commonly in young patients. So if you have intermediate uveitis in an elderly patient, you need to think of intraocular lymphoma. And as for infectious causes, always include syphilis in your differential diagnosis. For posterior uveitis, toxoplasmosis is the most frequent. In endemic country, think of TB, VKH in Asia, and again, always syphilis. And for pan-uveitis, your usual suspects for infectious causes, toxo, herpes group, and syphilis. Look for clues, know what you're looking for, do corneal aesthesia, gonioscopy, look at the iris looking for atrophy, and central location of KPs linked with hypertensive uveitis and sectorial atrophy should make you think of herpes. This is the oral triangle with granulomatous mutton fat KPs, and this is commonly found in sarcoidosis as well as in infectious uveitis such as toxoplasmosis, syphilis, TB, herpes. But always remember that granulomatous disease might start as non-granulomatous. We already discussed that high IOP should make you think of herpes, but also toxoplasmosis might give hypertensive uveitis. And always dilate both eyes. And with dilating the eye, you'll find not anterior uveitis, but suddenly you have intermediate posterior or panuveitis if you see chorioretinal lesion, snowbanking, snowballs. So if you still feel overwhelmed, go back to your patient, ask questions, go back to the past history, the history of presentation, the initial presentation, review of symptoms, and ask for trauma, food, surgery, medication. Beware of endophthalmitis if you have had prior eye surgery or in a case of trauma. Immunosuppressed, look at the med list. And always ask questions for travel, insect bites, looking for zoonosis in our ever interconnected world. Always rule out infectious causes. And we do know syphilis is back. You know your usual suspects, the toxoplasmosis, the viral diseases, but there's a vast array of potential pathogens emerging, and we'll go over some of the emerging infections, which are divided in four groups. So first, previously undetected or unknown agents, such as the COVID SARS-CoV-2 virus, which
I think we've again lost her. I think there's again some connection issue. I think we've lost her. So was this the last slide of her presentation? Was she towards the end of her presentation?
Maybe we, if we have her again, we can have from these slides onwards. Is it okay?
Yes, yes. So that's what I'm asking you. Was this like the kind of last slides of her presentation?
I have no clue.
She was concluding it. Okay, no problem. Whenever she joins in, we'll ask her to...
I remember the slide, so I'll ask her to continue from this slide.
Sure. So we can go ahead with Dr. Mudit. I think he started before she joined in.
No, Dr. Mudit has already finished.
Okay, so we can go ahead with our next speaker then.
I think she needs to stop share. Can you? Okay.
Yeah, it's done.
So we'll have her to continue with the next slides onwards. So meanwhile, it's a pleasure to invite our next speaker, Dr. Padma Malini Mahindradas. And I'm lucky that none of my panelists in this instruction course actually need any introduction. They're all esteemed faculty in the field of uveitis. Padma is the head of uveitis in Narayana Nethralaya, Bangalore, and everybody knows her for a tremendous work on imaging, on infectious uveitis, non-infectious uveitis, and we would all love to hear from Padma talking on infectious versus non-infectious uveitis. Over to you, Padma.
Thank you, Reema. Thank you, Reema, for the kind introduction. Good afternoon to all of you. So I'll be talking to you on infectious versus non-infectious uveitis clinical clues. Differentiating between infectious and non-infectious uveitis.
I cannot see your slides.
Pardon?
I cannot see your slides.
Ma'am, you have to do your slide share, screen share.
I've done screen share.
And Inasha, can we have the timer on the top? Because we don't, when we hear the speaker giving presentation, we cannot see the timer simultaneously.
Hello. The timer is there now.
Hello, I'm back. I'm sorry. Hello.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. So we have Dr. Padma presenting and then we'll take Dr. Mari's presentation from the slides that she finished.
Yeah. Okay. So I'll go back.
After you finished on the coronavirus disease, we can continue from your slides after that. After this talk, after Dr. Padma finishes. Padma, can we have...
Perfect.
Sure. Yeah. Good afternoon to all of you.
Yeah, your slides are not visible.
The kind introduction and invitation. I'll be talking to you on infectious versus non-infectious uveitis clinical clues.
Padma, slides.
Between infectious...
Padma, your slides.
Ma'am, your slides are not visible, so I would want you to do the share screen option.
I've done it.
We cannot see your slides or your presentation yet. So click on the share screen once again so that we all will be able to see it.
Padma, you can go to the next presenter and then come back.
Padma, any problem you're getting?
Do we have somebody from the technical team who can help her sharing her screen, her presentation?
Do you want me to finish my talk?
Oh, all right. We'll have you, Dr. Padma.
There you go.
Yes, ma'am,
there you go.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, your screen is visible now.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. So go ahead, Padma.
Yeah. That differentiating between infectious and non-infectious uveitis is of paramount importance in the diagnosis and management of uveitis. I will take certain clinical clues how you can differentiate between the two. Clinical signs such as ipopion, scleroUveitis, retinitis or retinochoroiditis. In these three entities, how do we differentiate between infectious and non-infectious? Let's see. First, we will take ipopion. Ipopion uveitis can present in autoimmune or immune-mediated diseases, infectious uveitis, or in masquerade syndrome. commonly we see in HLA-B27 associated uveitis or Behçet's disease in autoimmune uveitis, various infective uveitis, and also leptospirosis can present with Ipomoean uveitis in South Indian population with large masquerades here in a case of a retinoblastoma. So we will take three entities. In infectious uveitis, secondary endogenous endophthalmitis, the Ipomoean will have convex configuration in, with, associated with increased reaction in the anterior chamber with the fibrin, with the media haze and the posterior segment involvement. In HLA-B27 associated uveitis, we get sticky Ipomoean with fibrin reaction in anterior chamber. In Behçet's disease, we get free and mobile Ipomoean. So based on this morphology, we can differentiate between these three entities. We'll see a case example of a 53-year male presented with redness and pain with blurred left eye. History of similar episodes is happening on and off for the past 1 year. He gave history of low backache. On examination, we could see the Ipomoean uveitis with fibrinous reaction. This is a slit where I'm showing the presence of Ipomoean with increased reaction. We made the diagnosis of recurrent acute non-granulomatous anterior uveitis with Ipomoean. On investigation, he had stenosis of the sacroiliac joint with HLA-B27 was positive. So this particular patient was put on systemic steroids and systemic immunosuppressive therapy and treated accordingly. The next case is a case of a young female who's about 28 years who presented with Ipomoean panuveitis. On systemic evaluation, she had vorogenital ulceration. Here you could see the free and mobile Ipomoean, multiple yellowish white lesions, it's a multifocal retinitis. This is an immune-mediated multifocal retinitis in a case of a Behçet's disease. She responded well to systemic steroids and cyclosporine therapy. The next case is a 21-year female presented with sudden decrease in vision. She gave history of gastroenteritis for which she was treated with systemic antibiotics and IV fluid administrations in the rural setting. Subsequently, within a few hours, she had decreased vision in both eyes. Here you could see the organized exudates presenting in the form of an Ipomoean with granulomatous KPs and fibrinous reaction in the right eye and also in the left eye. Here we could see the kind of a fine to medium-sized deposits with jam-packed cells in the anterior chamber. And posterior segment involvement was also confirmed by the PET scan. So she has got bilateral granulomatous panuveitis, most likely secondary to endogenous endophthalmitis was made. On evaluation, she also had increased pus cells in the urine, but however, the culture was negative. She underwent a AC tap, showed KOH and fungal filaments, and also the panfungal genome was positive. So she was treated with intravitreal, initially antibiotics, subsequently antifungal agents with systemic antifungal therapy resulted in resolution of infections and inflammation in this eye. So it is important in this particular case, the IV fluid administration was a clue along with the KP and Ipomoean morphology. So many times if you pay attention to the history and the clinical clues can help us to differentiate what could be the probable etiology in these cases. Next is a pigmented Ipomoean, which rarely we see. This is commonly described in Listeria monocytogenes infection. It can also can present in malignant melanoma, rarely in ocular tuberculosis have been described. We next move on to retinitis, retinochoroiditis. Here we have three different entities, the retinitis secondary to post-fever retinitis. Here you have retinitis lesions. Here is a case of a choroiditis, it's a multifocal choroiditis. Clinically, we make the diagnosis in choroiditis. The lesions are located underneath the retinal vessels. They are ill-defined yellowish white lesions. Whereas in retinitis, you have whitish to yellowish lesions, ill-defined borders, and it is we cannot make out the retinal vessels. Coming to a case example, a 65-year male, diabetes mellitus, is an hypertensive. He underwent a renal transplant, presented with decreasing vision. He had anterior vitreous cells in the left eye. He was on mycophenolate mefitil, systemic steroids, and also tachograph for a post-renal transplant status. This is a fundus photograph showing vitritis with yellowish white ill-defined retinal lesion suggestive of a retinitis. When you watch carefully, in addition to the retinitis, we could see a pigmented lesion adjacent to the lesion. That gives us a clue. Here you have reactivated lesions adjacent to the area of a pigmented scar. That gives us a clue. Probably it is secondary to toxoplasmosis. Even though the patient does not have classical head light in the fog appearance, because of the systemic immunosuppressive therapy and immunocompromised state. So OCT shows the presence of posterior vitreous detachment and full thickness involvement, the opacification affecting the full thickness layer along with the choroidal involvement, suggesting it's a case of retinochoroiditis. On investigation, the patient had significant increase in serological titer of toxoplasma IgG and also B1 gene for toxoplasma was positive. This patient was treated with systemic clindamycin along with continuation of systemic immunosuppressive therapy, resulted in resolving lesion. You can see the completely healed chorioretinal scar. Not to miss such clue, such as healed chorioretinal, not to miss the scar, which gave us a clue in this case to suspect toxoplasmosis. Whenever the toxo heals, it forms epiretinal membrane with healed chorioretinal scar cases. So toxoplasmosis, diagnosed based on the clinical presentation of head light in the fog appearance, most of the times you could see the reactivated active lesions adjacent to the area of the scar or away from the area of the scar. How do we differentiate this from other entities? The next is acute retinal necrosis. Here again, it's a full thickness involvement of the retina with necrosis is seen. Epidermic retinitis, also yellowish lesions. Here we could see the hyperreflectivity in the inner retinal layer with after shadowing with SRF is seen. Dr. Mudit also showed here we could see the lesions coming from the choroid into the outer retinal layer. It's classically described in the case of a candida endophthalmitis. So based on these features, we can differentiate between the entities. The next comes the choroiditis. So commonly what we see is a tubercular choroiditis. You could be present in the form of yellowish white lesions underneath the vessels, can be associated with retinal vasculitis, that is scar along the vessels. Can have varied presentations like serpiginous-like choroiditis, subretinal abscess, choroidal tubercle. These are the various morphological variation of tuberculosis. Here is a case of a 45-year-old female presented with granulomatous panuveitis where we can see the Kopis and Busakos nodules, and fundus shows multiple millet-sized choroidal nodules are seen in both eyes. This is classically described in a case of a sarcoidosis. Based on this morphology, sarcoidosis was suspected and chest X-ray revealed bilateral hilar lymphadenopathy, and also biopsy confirmed it's a case of a non-caseating granuloma. Next, we'll move on to the entity sclerouveitis. Can have diffuse or nodular scleritis associated with uveitis. Here is a case of a diffuse anterior scleritis with uveitis, secondary to granulomatosis polyangiitis based on associated sinusitis and positive C ANCA titer. Patient responded well to systemic steroids and systemic immunosuppressive therapy. Here is a case of a multiple nodular unilateral scleritis. Here the patient presents with Woodstick injury. You could see the multiple nodular lesions, sometimes could be pus pointing. Incision and drainage revealed it's due to the gram-positive organism, and this patient responded well to topical and systemic antibiotic therapy. So whenever we come across a patient with history of trauma, multiple nodularity with pus-pointing lesions, we need to rule out infective scleritis in our setting. To conclude, working on uveitis is like being a detective, putting the unlikely clues together to arrive at the correct diagnosis. Clinical clues helps us to differentiate a non-infectious uveitis. Thank you for your attention. I'll be happy to take any questions.
Thank you so much, Padma. Thank you so much, Padma. So with this, we move on to our next speaker, and we will have Dr. Mary Aubin at the end of the talks by the speakers, because I texted her and I came to know that she has almost half a presentation left. So we don't want any further interruption so that we can have a talk smoothly at the end of the session. So with this, we move on to Manisha. Manisha again needs no introduction. She's heading the vitreoretina and uveitis services at Dr. Shroff Eye Center, New Delhi. She'll be talking of her experience and errors in clinical judgment in terms of non-infectious uveitis. So over to you, Manisha.
Thank you, Reema. A very good afternoon to all of you. And thank you, AIOS and Reema, for making me a part of this interesting session today. So I would be just sharing my own experience of having certain errors in judging non-infectious uveitis. Now let's move on to the first case, a young 34-year-old male patient with a history of injury with a fist, diminution of vision for last 1 month with pain and redness in the left eye and a vision as low as hand movements. On slit lamp examination, you had all the features suggestive like that of an endophthalmitis with congestion, AC reaction, a hypopyon, fibrin in the pupillary area, and a very faint red glow. If you see the B scan, the echoes, there were several echoes in the vitreous cavity, the retina was on, and the previous treating ophthalmologist had gone ahead and done an AC tap and sent for microbiological examination. The patient was already on these various topical medication when the patient presented to us, and also a tablet ciprofloxacin orally was being given to the patient. The microbiology report, however, was negative and the culture was still awaited. But the patient, since the patient was not responding to the treatment, the patient thought of seeking a second opinion. And after having gone through 5 days of this ongoing treatment, the patient finally presented to us. So I think the most important thing for us to is not go with the diagnosis made by another person. And it's always to start afresh with the history taking. So on re-evaluation and on history taking, we found that the patient did have a history of recurrent oral ulcers in the cheek. And before the development of the ocular symptoms, the patient also had a very vague history of joint pain with a history of headache. And when we examined the patient systemically, as even Dr. Aubin was just mentioning that you have to see the patient in total, we found that there were these healing ulcers present on the inside of the cheek area. There was a very dense vitritis with some evidence of vasculitis that you could see on the posterior pole of the retina. Fundus fluorescein angiography done in the patient put everything to rest, and you could see this typical fern pattern appearance of the vasculitis, which clinched the diagnosis. So we made a diagnosis of Behçet's disease, which was misdiagnosed as a post-traumatic endophthalmitis in this young patient. And what clinched the diagnosis in this patient was a positive history of recurrent oral ulcers and also the FFA picture of a classical fern pattern appearance of the vasculitis. The patient was put on oral and topical steroids. Cycloplegics were continued. The patient was also added with azathioprine, and the patient extremely responded very well to the treatment and did very well. So here the error was that you had diagnosed a non-infectious entity as a misdiagnosed infectious pathology. And the reason being of all the signs and symptoms, which were very much suggestive of an infection following the trauma the patient had had. Moving on to my second patient, a 28 years old female patient with blurring of vision and floaters in the right eye for last 1 year. The vision was 612 N9 in the right eye. She was often on oral steroids for last 1 year for past rhinitis, had already developed a complication with the ongoing steroids in the form of secondary glaucoma being treated with 2 anti-glaucoma medications, and had turned a borderline diabetic. Now, when we did an anterior segment examination on slit lamp, you find these fine stellate granulomatous KPs. There was loss of iris crypts, which is extremely important in our population, and an evidence of a posterior subcapsular cataract. When you did a fundus examination, you had a vitreous condensation with very few cells, and OCT put everything to rest. There was no evidence of any cystoid macular edema, and it was an absolutely a normal foveal contour. So here the errors in clinical judgment were that the Fuchs heterochromic uveitis had been misdiagnosed as past rhinitis with secondary complications, and due to long-term steroids, glaucoma and diabetes had already developed because of the ongoing corticosteroids for last 1 year. This is the most underdiagnosed non-infectious uveitic entity, and what clinched the diagnosis was the loss of iris crypts, which you often find in Indian population, unlike the heterochromia, what you see in Western population. absence of cystoid macular edema on OCT, which again is a very important feature for past splenitis, and absence of posterior synechia, again found in 95% of the patients of past splenitis. So here the error was that you had diagnosed one non-infectious entity as another non-infectious entity, which apparently did not require steroids, and the patient already was suffering from all kinds of complications secondary to the long-term steroids in the form of diabetes and glaucoma. My last patient is a 23 years old boy, bilateral diminution of vision for last 1.5 months, history of penetrating injury to the right eye with an iron rod 3 months back, and a scleral tear repair with a VR surgery involving foreign body removal and a silicone oil injection. The vision was very low in both the eyes, and the patient had been diagnosed as a tubercular uveitis in the left eye somewhere else. The patient had already been started on ATT and steroids for last 1 month. There was a history of contact with his brother who had been diagnosed with pulmonary TB. The Mantoux was also borderline high. When we did a slit lamp examination, the right eye showed an AC reaction with aphakia and with an inferior PI, secondary to the VR surgery that had been performed in the past. When we examined the left eye, there were frank mutton fat KPs with AC reaction and very few cells in the anterior vitreous. We did a fundus examination of the left eye, which showed an extensive vitritis with an exudative retinal detachment and query a yellowish deep-seated lesion suggestive of probably a choroidal granuloma, which confused the previous treating ophthalmologist. The right eye, of course, showed a well-attached retina with silicone oil in situ. Now, what was interesting in this patient was that there was a history of deafness in this patient, and when we referred this patient to our ENT department, they actually confirmed that the patient was having a neurosensory deafness. So revising our diagnosis and treating the patient accordingly, we diagnosed the patient suffering from sympathetic ophthalmia, which had been misdiagnosed elsewhere as a tubercular granulomatous uveitis with exudative detachment. Subsequently, we stopped ATT. We put the patient on IVMP, followed by oral steroids and oral azathioprine. And you see the timeline of this patient at presentation. He had extensive vitritis, exudative RD, with a vision as low as counting fingers. 2 months subsequent to the treatment being given by us, the vision had improved to 636/69. The disc was still hyperemic. There was an inferior retinal detachment with attached macula. And 15 months later, the patient had a typical sunset glow fundus, and the vision had dropped marginally to 612. The reading vision had dropped, but still the patient continued having a useful vision. Now, if you see the change in the level of the deafness, it was initially 60 decibels, which was extremely high. And now after the treatment, even the neurosensory deafness had improved to a loss of only 20 decibels. So sympathetic ophthalmia had been misdiagnosed as tubercular granulomatous uveitis with exudative detachment, query granuloma.
All of this discussion, at least with me,
Why was this misdiagnosis made? It was because of the history of contact with
Okay, fine. मैंने तुम्हारा stand लिया. मेरा काम था तुमको आके बताना. मेरा काम था उस party में नहीं जाना.
Can I please request everybody to mute their mics? हाँ,
जब तुझे बाद में तू वापस मेरे को आके बोलता.
Mic is on.
The point here is कि तू मेरे को वापस आके बोलता कि you know मेरे friends से तू बात कर रही है. उसने मेरे को पहले ही बोल दिया था कि तुम.
So there was a history of contact. The Mantoux was positive and the patient was having a granulomatous uveitis. But what clinched the diagnosis in this patient was the history of penetrating injury in the right eye, history of a surgical intervention done, the retrolental cells with the granulomatous uveitis in the other eye, and last but not the least, the neurosensory deafness. And we apparently published this case because it was a learning for us that sympathetic ophthalmia can also present with a neurosensory deafness, which was actually a rare presentation. So I would just conclude by saying that whenever a patient is not responding to treatment, start afresh, right from start taking the history again. Give the patient a very patient hearing, and many a times the patient himself may be telling you his or her own diagnosis. We should not fall in love with our own diagnosis, and we should always be open to revise your or someone else's diagnosis. Don't get carried away by the investigations as they just add to your clinical diagnosis, but you can't base your entire judgment on the clinical, on the lab investigations. And a good clinician corrects the mistake on time before it is too late. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Manisha. I always enjoy your cases, very well presented and extremely good experience, learning points for all of us. So thanks, Manisha. And
now thank you, Reema.
An honor to have you. And now we move on to the other direction of uveitis, moving from non-infectious to infectious. And we have for this Dr. Balamurugan, who's consultant in uveitis services of Arvind Eye Hospital, Puducherry. And everybody knows him as a very dedicated uveitis specialist and for all the work that he's doing for the USI newsletter. Very hardworking. Over to you, Dr. Bala.
Good afternoon, one and all. At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Reema and the organizers for giving me this wonderful opportunity. Mistakes in infectious uveitis. So let me start with the first case. This was a 42-year-old lady who presented with pain redness with a keratouveitis. And the resident started the patient on topical steroids. And within 3 days, when the patient came for reading of the mantle, there was a very violent flare-up. And we did a scraping and sent for the lactose cotton phenol blue. And the surprising history that was missed was the native treatment for the injury of the vegetable matter with the patient confounded in initially. So, Aspergillus fumigatus was identified, and we have to be very careful in asking a delicate history, and the fungal uveitis can flare up. So such even an anti-uveitis can cause problem in an infection scenario like India. Sometimes we are faced with some negative response and we get a feeling like this. So let me shift gears. This was an 18-year-old young boy who presented with pain associated with ipsilateral headache and high-grade fever of 5 days duration. On examination, anterior segment was apparently normal. The vision in the left eye was reduced to 1/60. There were very faint cells in the left eye, and the fundus showed dull-looking RP-like lesion, and the media was fairly clear. And we were suspecting possibly a possibility of viral uveitis and started the patient on antivirals. After reading the mantle, it was started. What surprised us was the other eye vision also got involved, and we ordered additional tests like HIV, TPHA, and this was appearance with multiple subretinal lesions involving the macula, and there were RP mostly. And the OCT showed a full thickness hyperreflective lesion temporal to the disc. And there was a marked progression of the foveal thinning within a short span of 5 days to a week. And fovea has gone for thinning and atrophy. And the FFP also showed a few leaks in the early and late frames. And the patient was last to follow, and he presented back to us after a month. Again, the macula was, again, the thinning increased, and there was a totally disorganized architecture of the layers of the retina with some fluid collection. We ordered additional tests like dengue, chikungunya, HIV, HPSCAG, and Weill Felix toxoplasma. Everything came out negative. So we did include this measles IgG, which really came out positive, and sudden progression of macular thinning and disorganized OCT. So the diagnostic criteria of SSPE include the rising titers of antibody titers plus or minus the CSF titers. So what is not feasible is the brain biopsy, but the CSF tab with the raised globulin or oligoclonal glands could also help along with the EEG and the clinical presentation of myoclonus. So the drugs used for treating SSPE include a whole lot of amantadine, cimetidine steroids, interferon alpha beta, isoprenosine, immunoglobulins, and ribavirin. What is interesting is the combo of intraventricular interferon alpha plus oral isoprenosine is the best treatment that has been published. And this is one interesting article where they said the age of onset of SSP less than 12 years and the disappearance of the periodic complexes, the tendency of normalization in the EEG and progressive increase in the measles titer all are associated with a favorable outcome. Normally, SSP has got a poor outcome. When you encounter all these pointers, we can be a little happy that it has a favorable outcome. So the point to deal in the SSP inflammation is little as sparse, vitreous inflammation, like in our case, or involvement of the retinal vessels or the satellite lesions. They help in delineating SSP from toxone basis. So clinically, when we encounter a lack of spheroid response, we need to keep all these things in mind. Are we dealing with a possible very violent infectious uveitis, or it could be even non-infectious uveitis present in an aggressive way, or fungal uveitis, or it could be a masquerade, or in a metabolic masquerade, or an ocular ischemic syndrome. So we should keep all these options open and evaluate in those directions. So sometimes we get this conflict between clinical sense and investigations, and we are in dilemma to proceed. This was one such case where a 55-year-old lady present with pain in left eye of 5 days duration associated with the characteristic ubocular history of evening rise of temperature and night sweats, which was initially missed but subsequently elicited. There was no specific history except that there was a history of type 2 diabetes and oral hypoglycemia. The anterior segment was apparently normal. The posterior segment in the left eye showed sort of choroidal or associated with the retinal lesion, and the B scan showed an RC elevation associated with shallow retinal detachment. The OCT here showed a focal ISOS loss, and the perilesional and the perimacular OCT showed ellipsoid zone loss along with SRF, and there is a very characteristic RP elevation. So associated with the retinal detachment. So we thought that we are dealing with the left eye posterior uveitis and possibly had the secondary tuberculosis sarcoid in our mind, along with an amelanotic choroidal melanoma and solitary idiopathic choroiditis because of the unilateral presentation. And we were keeping all these options in mind. And after 3 days, this was a fundus picture, and we got all the reports, and the ESR was little elevated. MAT2 was 0 millimeter, and we thought that a possibility of tuberculosis is very little in that patient. So we did an FFA. It showed a punctate hyperfluorescence in the late venous phase. In the late phase, there is an increased hyper. In the late venous phase, we also encountered a punctate hyperfluorescence and an increased hyper in the late phase as well. So the other findings were the hypofluorescence and the hypo turning into hyper adjacent to the original lesions. We ordered an HRCT scan, and it showed a ground glass opacity. In the present scenario, we'll be thinking in terms of COVID, but you know, the radiologist gave us that all these could point towards a compensated left cardiac compromise and interstitial lung disease. And the treatment was the oral steroids was started at 15 milligram. And we ordered for an MRI arm because we still had the secondary of choroidal melanoma in our mind. And surprisingly, the vision reduced to 6/24. Then there was increasing configuration of the lesion along with subtle hemorrhages around. This MRI arm gave us a clue that we are dealing with possible early uveal melanoma. So we were keeping our hands crossed. Are we dealing with non-tubercular etiology or early uveal melanoma? These can also show there is an increased RCS elevation, which was initially captured as well. Along with oral spheroid, you see a distinct progression of the lesion, which is seeping downwards. And we repeated the FFA, and it confirmed that all these, there is a definite progression along with tipping of the diet towards the inferior arcade. And we also did a PCR, which showed there is a positivity for nested PCR MPB64. So with that in mind, we stopped the oral steroid and initiated anti-TB treatment. Oral steroid was restarted after a gap of 5 days. And look at what happened. There is a marked fibrosis. And there is a marked regression, and the OCT also showed that there is an improvement in the neurosensory detachment, and all these RP elevations has reduced. The interesting fact about this third case was there is no pointer for tuberculosis, MAN2, but for the history, and the PCR was definitely helping us to reach the diagnosis of tuberculosis. And the MRI and FFA can sometimes confuse us. And as in this case, the MRI pointed towards choroidal melanoma, and metastasis was also pointed based on the FFA picture. PCR report takes 3 weeks. Sometime in those 3 weeks, we need to be very careful in initiating ATT. And this was one interesting article, again from PJ Group, where they published a similar masquerading TB versus melanoma. And the point of difference with our case was the systemic features of tuberculosis were characteristically absent except for the history part. So the rest of the findings are similar. And the TB, I'll finish in a few slides. The ocular tuberculosis masquerading as ocular tumor is commonly reported. And they have concluded that the ocular tumor had a very presentation. And this is my last slide. The treatment speaks 1,000 powerful words and need to pay attention to listen to those powerful words. And don't believe only the investigation, whether it is MR, CT, or whatever it is. Be clinical. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Bala. Thanks a lot, Bala, for the wonderful cases, learning experience from all of them. So, can we have our next speaker, Dr. Amit Khosla? It's a pleasure to listen. Can you hear me?
Yes, Reema, you're audible.
I can hear you.
It's a pleasure to invite Dr. Amit Khosla from New Delhi on ocular science presenting manifestations of a systemic disease. Amit has a lot of vast experience in dealing with patients with very refractory uveitis and treating them with immunosuppression, biologicals, and he has a very strong team with rheumatological specialists, and he's from Sir Gangaram Hospital. Let's have you, Amit. Over to you.
Thank you, Reema, for the invitation. The ocular symptoms of a systemic disease may be coexisting, may be preceding the systemic disease or later associated. So I'll be sharing two patients who had the disease with the systemic and found prior to the systemic disease. This is a patient which is classical, a doctor who presented to me with these lesions, and somebody had diagnosed the Stoxo. The VDL report the doctor was carrying was negative. The doctor was an HIV positive patient. We suspected syphilis, so we repeated the VDL and it came out positive. And after 1 month of treatment with penicillin, the lesion has started to resolve, but the vision didn't recover completely. So as Mudit has shown, that the HIV with syphilis is a great mimicker and can be the presenting disease. Here's another patient who presented, not a known case of HIV, who presented with this lesion, had been treated with steroids for choroiditis. On biomarker showed both HIV and VDL positive. The next case, the 12-year-old female who presented to a dermatologist with rashes, developed weakness, fever, pain in the abdomen, and blurring of vision. So when I checked the patient had this picture and was diagnosed with pancreatitis, a presenting feature of SLE with pancreatitis. So we made a differential diagnosis of posterior retinopathy or a retinitis. The patient was given steroids, cyclophosphamide, and then put on MMF. It was the initial OCT at presentation. The patient resolved in 1 month's time with a 6-9 vision. So in SLE, the SLE retinopathy can be the presenting feature. Sometimes the markers may not be positive, the antiphospholipid may not be positive, but become positive later. So there are the various case reports of pustular retinopathy, one from Shankar Netrale and one from Saudi and one from other countries, which has similar picture showing of the similar presentation. The next commonest cases which we see is uveitis with arthritis, and the commonest being ankylosing, JIA, and the spondyloarthropathy, and the vasculitis. So basically, if you have a patient of HLA B27, you can have psoriatic, reactive, inflammatory bodies, and ankylosing spondylitis. And the lesions can be diverse. Besides acute, you can have conjunctivitis, keratitis, scleritis. So basically, the classical picture is that a patient presents with one eye active anterior uveitis, maybe alternating with the other eye. The classical features are fibrin and maybe a hypopyon, and you go into remission between two attacks. Now, I want to advise the patient, does the patient have a risk for spondyloarthropathy or has an associated one? So 66% of the HLA B27 patient will develop spondyloarthropathy, but 6% of the HLA negative will also develop spondyloarthropathy. So we ask all patients for a history of back pain, which relieves it on waking up. It is early in the morning. And if the patient has, then we refer to the rheumatologist for further evaluation. In JIA, we have six types of JIAs. One is a systemic onset. The classical one is a white eye with oligoarthritis, which is ANA positive. And then one entity which we have JIA with is enthesitis HLA B27, which presents as acute red light like the adult HLA B27. So in our series, we found that majority of patients with the acute anterior red eyes, one with the enthesitis rated, the HLA B27 was a higher picture, because now with, as we are doing ANA with imlifidase, we are picking up more patients. Majority of the patients with JIA have an acute red eye. So I was in a dilemma. A patient of 6 years old presented with bilateral red eye with the limb, the anterior uveitis, no cataract, no BSK, no synechia. Both the HLA B27 and ANA was positive at a enthesitis in the heel. So we started thinking it is a HLA B27 uveitis. We started the topical steroid and NSAIDs, but the child had a recurrence on tapering the steroid and then did not resolve. So we started methotrexate. So both the ANA, the chronic uveitis, and the acute were present in this patient. The other lesion which we present is the scleritis. When you have a scleritis, you must think of a GPA, which is the commonest. This patient had no lung or renal involvement, only a saddle node with a sinus involvement. Initially, we gave methotrexate, but did not resolve, and we added rituximab. In about a year's time, the scleritis took time to resolve. So basically, scleritis may be present with granulomatous and polyangiitis, rheumatoid arthritis, relapsing polychondritis, SLE, IBD, and even in an orbital inflammatory syndrome, when you have a posterior scleritis, remember IgG4 disease can cause a posterior scleritis. I want to show a case which is quite complicated, but it shows that the diagnosis may be made down the year, not in the biomarkers may not be positive. So when I saw the child, the patient was 11-year-old male, had arthritis at 9 months, was diagnosed as systemic onset GI with fever, was started on methotrexate, but after a few years, the parent shifted to alternate therapy, and he came back with multiple fractures found to be severely osteopenic at 7 years. At 7 years, the patient was started on tocilizumab for 1 year. The disease flared up after stopping the treatment, started again. At age of 10 years, the child presented with GI infection, septic shock, and an episode of red eye. So I went and saw the patient. The patient had healed uveitis with posterior sinus. This is my first interaction with the patient. The patient developed intolerance to methotrexate, was given leflunomide. So the patient on regular follow-up had 6-9 vision with refraction and a posterior synechia. Currently, the patient developed a hypopyon with anterior uveitis and a vision loss. On examination of the fundus, the left eye showed the retinal involvement, the vascular block, which resolved with steroids and immunosuppression. This is November of 2016, when the patient resolved with intravenous steroids and adalimumab. And then the patient started creatinine going up, and the ACE level now repeated showed elevated. And the patient bone biopsy showed granuloma, and the renal biopsy showed these granulomas, which is suggestive of sarcoidosis. So the early onset sarcoidosis, which is present, didn't have the markers of blasting, but the patient developed sarcoid. So just to show that systemic disease can present at a later date. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Amit, for again wonderful cases and to show how the uveitis entity can actually lead us to systemic diagnosis. So we move on to our next talk. This is Dr. Jyothirmay Biswas doesn't need any introduction. And congratulations once again, sir, for the recently awarded BK Narayan Award. And sir is getting the much deserved awards every time. So, and it's a pleasure to have you, sir. And sir will be talking on masquerades in uveitis.
Slides.
So I'll be talking on masquerade syndrome in uveitis, the tumors appearing as uveitis. So I'll be talking about clinical pathological correlation of masquerade syndrome. Masquerade syndrome can be neoplastic and non-neoplastic. I'll be talking about neoplastic masquerade syndrome in uveitis that comprises of 2.5 to 5% of the uveitis, mostly in the posterior segment. I'll straight go to a few cases. First case is a case which I have seen about 20 years back, 8-year-old girl, persistent hypopia and uveitis, not responding to the topical and systemic steroid. At this point of time, I took help of my seniors who said that, why don't you go into the anterior chamber and took into the fluid. We did that and we found basophilic cohesive cells with hyperchromatic nuclei and scanty cytoplasm. This is obvious of a case of a retinoblastoma. Final diagnosis was retinoblastoma, which presented as pseudohypopia. The second case is also interesting. It's an 11-year-old male child. We don't suspect retinoblastoma in 11-year-old male child. Dimness of vision in the right eye for 5 months and redness for 2 months duration. Vision was less, 660 and 36 in the right eye. And if you look at the anterior segment, intraocular pressure was raised, fundus at heady blue. And what we look found in the anterior chamber, there are organized exudative mass as well as the dusting of the cornea with exudates. This patient and the slit lamp examinations, whole cornea is studied with exudates. At this point of time, we did ultrasound of the right eye. It did not show retinoblastoma, clear media with attached retina. But UBM showed a medium reflective ciliary body mass. Ciliary body mass with the 3.6 millimeter from 3 o'clock to 6 o'clock. We suspected at this stage there is something wrong and there might be tumor in the eye. And retinoblastoma was our first diagnosis. We did that enucleation of the right eye due to that extensive involvement of the anterior chamber. And you were correct. It was an undifferentiated retinoblastoma. And under surface of the cornea, anterior chamber, iris, trabecular meshwork, and ciliary body is involved. Retina choroid is optic nerve is not involved. And you can see this is the cornea. And you can see the posterior surface of the cornea is studded with the tumor cells. And you can see the tumor cells in the anterior chamber as well as the ciliary body involvement. This is a diffuse dusting of the corneal endothelium by retinoblastoma cells is very unique and we reported in this case report. So anterior segment masquerade retinoblastoma, a few words, usually diffuse infiltrating type of retinoblastoma, around 6 years of age, non-familiar, unilateral, often fundus view is limited by anterior chamber exudate, vitreous hemorrhage or vitritis. Most of this case, interestingly, do not show calcification on ultrasound, which produces a diagnostic dilemma. Our third case is not my case, it's from PGI Chandigarh, 6-year-old girl diagnosed as a case of acute lymphoblastic leukemia and presented as a hypopia. And peripheral smear showed a large immature lymphoblast suggestive of leukemia. And this patient restarted chemotherapy but died within a few weeks. What is a pseudohypopia in a child should not be taken loosely. And red flag sign of malignancy. Case 4 is a posterior segment. This one is a tumor lesion. 55-year-old man developed bilateral hypopia. And Sudarshan has seen this case. And his peripheral blood count to routine examination showed chronic myeloid leukemia. Blood smear, I'll show you, showed myoblast cells. And this patient was found to be having a chronic leukemia. And this is a thing called when you see a bilateral hypopia without inflammatory signs in elderly, you think of malignancy. This we have published, bilateral hypopia as a presenting feature of chronic myeloid leukemia. Case 5 is also quite interesting. This patient I have shown you many times is presented as a choroiditis kind of lesion, was thought to be a tubercular choroiditis. And then when he came to that one us, we found leopard skin-like appearance. We thought that is a not a choroiditis, and we did that vitreous biopsy, which is negative. Subsequently, with a strong suspicion of lymphoma, we did the fine needle aspiration biopsy, which showed lymphoma. 6 months after, patient indeed developed CNS lymphoma. This is a story of another patient, 51-year-old lady, who came with a blurring of vision and floaters, and this patient had this multiple choroidal nodules. This patient gave history of having contact with the TB, joint pain with fever. The clinicians thought there is a tubercular choroideitis, went ahead and did PCR for MTB done, which was negative. We suspected a primary intraocular lymphoma, but vitreous biopsy showed inflammatory cells. MYD88 also negative. FNAB done, which showed atypical lymphoid cells, and immunohistochemistry showed CD20 positive. Intravitreal injection rituximab given, and the patient responded to treatment. I'm just showing that the FNAB specimen, you can see the necrotic background, which is very characteristic of lymphoma with the large lymphoid cells over here. This is a cell block showed this necrotic background is multiple pleomorphic lymphoma cells with hyperchromatic nuclei and scanty cytoplasm. CD20 was positive, which is a B-cell marker, and so I'm suggesting of it is a B-cell lymphoma. MRI brain was normal. PET CT scan at this stage was no metastasis. The patient had another eye lesions developed as a choroidal nodule, and we did that OCT, and this showed that the subretinal pigment epithelial deposits. Another case is a diagnostic dilemma. This is a solitary lesion, but this time we didn't do the biopsy. You could see that the patient has typical lesions of that leopard skin type of the lesion. OCT showed lymphoma. The patient is given an intravitreal rituximab injections after vitreous biopsy. Primary vitreoretinal lymphoma can present with the floaters and decreased vision, often missed as intermediate uveitis and choroiditis. Many of the times they thought, there many people think there is a tubercular choroiditis. Fundus autofluorescence can show granular hypofluorescence, and FFA showed initial space granular hypofluorescence state, and subretinal RPE for pre-RPE infiltrates and seen at the hypofluorescence. So how do you diagnose? Vitreous biopsy, FNAB, and choroidal biopsy should be done when as the lesions is that one in the serial order. So first vitreous biopsy, then vitreous FNAB, and subsequently negative choroidal biopsy. Vitreous biopsy, one of the important thing is the specimen should reach path lab within half an hour because the tumor cells are very friable and necrotic. And if necessary, vitreous biopsy is negative, we can do for a final laceration biopsy. If negative, one can go to that retinochoroidal lesions to a retinochoroidal or choroidal biopsy. This can be helpful in some situations, infectious as well as the malignant origin to lesion. So what we do that one, you do the cytopathology, cell block, histopathology of the tissue section, immunohistochemistry with T and B cell marker, interleukin IL-10, IL-6 ratio, and lastly, MYD88L265 mutations. So IL-10, IL-6 ratio is increased. More than 1.0 is suggestive of primary vitreoretinal lymphoma if you have got the facility. What's new is that MYD88L265 mutations in intraocular lymphoma. Its sensitivity is 88.9% in our hand, and specificity is 91.6%. So when you diagnose a lymphoma, it's imperative that you do an MRI brain to rule out CNS lymphoma. So high degree of clinical suspicion is important. Multiple biopsy and expert cytopathologist is required in diagnosis of muscular syndrome. Thank you very much. As pathology is there, so our practice in uveitis can improve. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. So I think we are about to finish the session, and we have only 5 minutes. Can we have Dr. Robin to conclude her talk? Yeah, would you be able to finish before 3:25, Dr. Robin?
Yes, I'll do my best. I'm just starting the screen share. All right. I'm very sorry about the prior interruption. I hope it doesn't cut short again. So I was just about to give you the fifth pearl to do a tailored workup. And what does that mean? Certainly there's a lot of investigation, but I would argue that the minimum workup for anything in uveitis would be syphilis, but you could also consider ruling out, of course, TB and sarcoidosis. The sixth pearl is to use caution with steroids, especially in if you suspect infectious disease, and this is extensive toxoplasmosis, iatrogenic post periocular multiple orbital four steroid injection, and it was very difficult to control. The seventh pearl, be prepared to change course. Of course, these common infectious uveitis may have atypical presentation. You know your usual suspects, but sometimes it's very difficult to distinguish one from the other. You can rely on some clues such as the chorioretinal scar near a new area of active lesion and also response to antitoxoplasmosis treatment. But sometimes you have no such clue, no such scar, and it can be very difficult to distinguish ARN from toxoplasmosis. So do go ahead and perform an AC tap or a diagnostic vitrectomy when in doubt. Always beware of the immunocompromised. It's usually infectious. And this is a CMV retinitis in an AIDS patient. You have your typical white necrosis with hemorrhages. This is the granular form in an immunosuppressed patient. And this is the frosted branch angiitis, again, in an AIDS patient. This is posterior outer retinal necrosis due to VZV, also in an AIDS patient. Again, diffuse toxoplasmosis, but this in a renal transplant patient. Be humble and know when to refer. It's better to confess ignorance than have dire consequences in your patient. And again, it can be very challenging to distinguish one cause from the other. Common saying is, if it walks like a duck, quacks like a duck, it must be a duck. Or if you hear hoofbeats, think of horses, not zebra, but zebra do occur. As in this patient who was initially misdiagnosed as ARN, had a recent zoster, PPD, cantiferon, chest X-ray were all negative. And fortunately we could identify during a diagnostic vitrectomy, mycobacterium, which was later labeled as Mycobacterium bovis. And he had actually miliary tuberculosis due to M. bovis. Fortunately, this is very rare. It's often a very poor outcome due to delay in treatment. Ocular TB is always very challenging. It requires a high degree of clinical suspicion. And this is another zebra, a young lady presenting on Christmas Eve with a chorioretinal lesion, misdiagnosed initially with toxoplasmosis, with poor response to treatment, which was antitoxoplasmosis med combined with oral steroids, and was found to have candida not only in the eye, but also in the brain, and responded very well to antifungal treatment. And this was due to a CAR9 genetic deficiency. Do not forget the masquerades. We just had a great talk by Dr. Biswas, and especially in the elderly, this was a case of intraocular lymphoma masquerading as ARN. So in conclusion, some take-home lessons. We've seen emerging and re-emerging infections in our global world. Ocular manifestations of various infectious disease, and certainly, as we've learned today, history and examination, your clinical skills are key. So I hope that you feel better equipped with all those wonderful talks we had to care for your uveitic patients. So thank you very much.
So thank you, Dr.
I ask a question to Dr. Do you see TB in Canada?
Yes, we do. It's rarer than in your country, but we do see. And we have to remember that not too long ago, in the 30s and 40s, actually, there were a lot of TB in North America. And actually, the old part of the hospital where I work was a sanatorium. So yes, we do see. And this gentleman actually had contact with TB as a young child. And he had also drank milk of unpasteurized. He was living on a farm in the region of Montreal, a few like in the rural part. And we're not sure where he encountered the M. bovis. It's been known to be much more common, especially in Mexico. And it was also known to travel to Mexico every few months per year for the last 10 years. So it's very difficult to know where it got the M. bovis from, but we do see M. tuberculosis and M. bovis much more rarely.
Do you know Dr. Jane Dessens? Jane Dessens, Montreal? No.
Jane Dessens? I'm not sure if I understand correctly. Jane?
Dessens. Dessens. He's from Canada.
Jean Deschaine. Yes, Jean Deschaine, of course. I'm sorry. Jean Deschaine is a uveitis specialist at McGill University. I've studied with him. I did the part of my fellowship with him. Yes, I do.
Okay. Thank you.
I'm sure he sends his regards.
Yeah, send my regards to him.
So very nice presentation, Dr. Mary. Nice meeting you. Yeah, I would like to know what is the COVID situations and what are the manifestations do you see in your part of the country? And Padma, here.
Yes. Thank you for the question. And I've started a data reporting for all COVID cases with eye manifestations. And actually, we don't see that much. We've seen a couple of conjunctivitis and the like. Usually when it's an acute, as in the ICU setting, you might see some thromboembolic or hemorrhages, but they're fleeting. So we don't end up seeing many of them. We have seen acute but again, it's indefinite. And the case I presented the picture with, it was a patient who presented again during the Christmas holiday. He was seen with hypertensive uveitis, only interior at the beginning, even with multiple dilated exam, only one eye unilateral, and then acquired COVID. And when I saw him during calls during the holiday, he had this new lesion on the posterior pole. And we were a bit at a loss, what was that? It looked like a primo infection with tuberculosis. But since he was, we had delayed ACTAP because of the COVID infection. So it was not infective anymore. I did perform ACTAP and everything was negative for viral toxoplasmosis. And they didn't perform the COVID on the PCR. Unfortunately, I asked for it, but it was not performed probably because of not enough sample left. So I diagnosed a primo infection with toxoplasmosis since it resolved with anti toxoplasmatic agent. And I've seen actually with the COVID vaccination, recurrence of toxoplasmosis, very early signs of toxoplasmosis in patients I've been following. So I usually, with patients with the very like perifoveolar lesion that I told them to increase their antitoxoplasmosis suppressive therapy just to prevent them from recurrence.
Thank you. Sorry to interrupt you, ma'am. Yes, so I think we are starting with the next session now. Our next speakers are already waiting. So a big thank you to all of you for joining us for this session. Thank you so much. We can now conclude it.
Thank you, Rima.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rima.
Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to see you all.
Yeah. Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Thank you, Rima.